as some thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Since there are many, His mercy is more. Amen. What patience would wait as we constantly wait? Father so tender is calling us home. He welcomes the weakest, the vilest, the poor. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord. His mercy is more, stronger than darkness, new every morn. Since they are many, His mercy is more. Since they are many, His mercy is more. Riches of kindness He lavished on us. His blood was the payment, His life was the cost. We stood neath the debt we could never afford. Amen. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord. His mercy is more, stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Could remember no wrongs we have done. Omniscient, all-knowing, He counts not their sum. Brought into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Hands up, praise the Lord. His mercy is more, stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Please.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Kathy O'Neill, and I'm really grateful to be here and being called to read the call to worship. And today, it is Psalm 150, the last psalm of the Psalms. Praise the Lord. Praise God in His sanctuary. Praise Him in His mighty heavens. Praise Him for His acts of power. Praise Him for His surpassing greatness. Praise Him with the sounding of the trumpet. Praise Him with the harp and lyre. Praise Him with timbrel and dancing. Praise Him with strings and pipe. Praise Him with the clash of cymbals. Praise Him with resounding cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Our hymns next will be Praise the Lord, Ye Heavens, Adore Him, and then O Worship the King.
Please stand. Thank you, Kathy. Praise the Lord. the Lord, ye heavens, adore him. Praise him, angels in the height. Sun and moon rejoice before him. Praise him, all ye stars of light. Praise the Lord, for he hath spoken. Worlds his mighty voice obeyed. Laws which never shall be broken, for their guidance he hath made. Worship, honor, glory, blessing, Lord, we offer unto thee. Young and old, thy praise expressing, in glad homage bend the knee. All the saints in heaven adore thee. We would bow before thy throne as the angels serve before thee. So on earth thy will be done.
Oh, worship the King.
Oh, worship the King, all glorious above, and gratefully sing his wonderful love. A shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, a pavilioned in splendor, and girded with praise. Oh, tell of his might, oh, sing of his grace, whose robe is the light, whose canopy's face, his chariots of wrath, the deep thunder clouds form, and dark is his path on the wings of the storm. Frail children of dust and feeble as frail, in thee do we trust, nor find thee to fail. Thy mercies how tender, how firm to the end. Our Maker, Defender, great Redeemer and Friend.
Please be seated. Let's pray. Frail children of dust, and feeble as frail, in thee we do trust, and you do not fail. Dear God, we come before you this morning. You will never fail. You're omniscient, omnipresent. And we come before you in our feebleness and in our failings to confess our sin before you. Hear our prayers, O God.
Thank you.
Thy mercies, how tender, how firm to the end, our Maker, Defender, Redeemer, and Friend. Thank you, Lord, for hearing our confessions and forgiving our sin. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please stand for Power of the Cross.
To see the dawn of the darkest day, Christ on the road to Calvary, tried by sinful men, torn and beaten then, nailed to a cross of oak. Is the power of the cross. Christ became sin for us, took the blame for the wrath. We stand forgiven. Pain written on your face, bearing the awesome weight of sin. Every bitter thought, every evil deed, crowning your blood-stained brow. It's the power the cross. Christ became sin for us, took the blame for the wrath. We stand forgiven at the cross. Now the grave really flees, now the ground beneath quakes as its maker bows his head. Curtain torn in two, the dead are raised to life. Finish the victory cry. This the power the cross. Christ became sin for us, took the blame for the wrath. We stand forgiven at the cross.
Oh, to see my name written in the wounds, for through your suffering I am free. Death is crushed to death, life is mine to live. One through your selfless love. This is the power. There's the power of the cross. Son of God, slain for us. What a love, what a cost. We stand forgiven. Forgiven. God bless you. Please be seated. And will the children come up with Mrs. Tuttle?
Good morning. Good morning, church. Hi, children. Come on up. Hi there. My little barefoot girl over there. Oh, so cute. We have some beautiful faces. I have a book for you today, and this is a really fun book. It's called My Favorite Book. And when I was 5, my pastor gave this to me. And my mom and dad would read it, not every night, but close to every night. So I wanted to share it with you because it's a really, really fun book. I gotta put my glasses on so I can see, though. So, it's called My Favorite Book. For this morning, with its light, for rest and shelter of the night, for health and food, for love and friends, for everything goodness sends, I am thankful. Now, birds are busy raising their babies. Sometimes they're bringing food to them in the morning when I wake. And sometimes when morning lights the sky and gladness fills the air, I feel like telling others of the beauty of our world. A bunch of magic keys is mine to make each day with gladness shine. Good morning is the magic key, which unlocks every day to me. When evening comes, good night, I say, and lock the door of that glad day. When at the table, if you please, take off from your bunch of keys. When friends give anything to me, I use my magic thank you key. But every day, I mean to see each chance to use a magic key. Do you guys have magic keys?
No.
Yeah, your please and thank yous. All things bright and beautiful, all things large and small, all things wise and wonderful, we must respect them all. And sometimes when trees are standing so tall with branches in the air, I feel like saying how large they are and I'm so very small. How wonderful my body and my mind, which I think, how wonderful to have my health and to be able to enjoy whatever I eat and drink. How faithfully each day I then must do the things I should to keep my body well and strong, my mind clean, pure, and good. But no one has to wind me up with string or with a key. I walk and talk, I run and laugh, I think, I hear, I see. The little stars are put to sleep and the sun wakes up each day, and I'm very glad for her. I'm a child who likes to run and play. How nice it is to stand and view the great big sky, so lovely and blue. I love my dog, and my dog loves me. He's my pet, and he plays with me. I'm kind to him in every way, and we are happy every day. Do you guys all have a dog? A lot of you do, don't you? Here's my little new red drum. Listen, it sounds dum 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 dum. How do friendly children play? Oh, I know. They share their blocks and share their toys with other little girls and boys because it's the right and happy way. When friends visit me someday, I'll share my ball to play. I think I like this picture book. We'll turn the pages as we look. I want to grow and do the things I should to be to others kind and good. And all I do and all I say to be more loving every day. Sing. About my birthday, it comes but once a year. Glad I am to live and grow, see and feel and hear. Children should be helpers and always want to be sharing work and happiness in their family. Do you guys do chores?
Yeah.
It helps out the family, doesn't it? Sometimes my daddy works at home to make our place look trim. And when he works out in the yard, I go along with him. I pick up old bones my dog has left and bits of paper while I talk. When daddy mows the grass, I sweep the cuttings off the walk. That would mean the sidewalk. First came sunshine, then came rain. We saw it again, it was growing grain. We saw it later, it was golden wheat, soon to be bread for someone to eat. Wow, not long ago, I helped Daddy plant seeds and rows out there. Some were such tiny little things, some rough and some smooth. There's a secret with each seed. It lies so small and quiet in the soft, warm ground. No one knows it's there. The seed keeps it secret so that it can grow safely and slowly. We had a shower yesterday. Not the type of shower you guys take, though. We had a shower yesterday, and now the sun is shining on our garden, There's something I've been wondering about. I wonder, how does a seed know just how to become a carrot and not something else? How does each seed know just what to be? There are rows of carrots and other kind of vegetables. There are different colors and they all taste different, but they all grow down there in that same dark soil. Dig and rake, spade and hoe, that's the way to make things grow. Down came rain and bright sunshine, up peep flowers, grass and vine. I was usually asleep by now when my parents read this book, my mom said. Thank you, farmers, and all those who bring us food. Thank each and every one of you. All of you are good. The door at grandmother's house is tall and wide. When I ring the bell, grandmother comes and smiles and says, "Come inside." My grandfather called from the pasture bars, "Come, see the daisies, they look like stars." Sure enough, the sloping field twinkled in the sun as if stars had fallen there. I picked some one by one. This beautiful world I love, this beautiful world, it was made for you, it was made for me. I love this beautiful world. I love the big round sun, it shines so clear and bright. It helps all things to grow and give us light. The sheep have curly wool to keep them warm. There's wool in the cloth of my winter coat new. The wool keeps the sheep warm, and warms me now too. I wrote in here. You can see my handwriting. It says, God loves me. We are thankful for this world so fair. We are thankful for the clothes we wear. We are thankful for the food we eat. We are thankful for the friends we meet. We are thankful for the birds that sing. We are thankful for everything. Dr. Seuss must have copied this book. God loves me. There is nothing I'd rather do than read a book and find out who were brave and kind and good and try to be just like them. And we are thankful for all kind and good. We are thankful, too, for our home and food. I'm just as glad as I can be that I belong to a family. I love my family, everyone. We work and play. We have some fun. But the sun is put to rest at night, and then come stars and moon. I'm glad, so glad, for I'm a child who goes to bed quite soon. Sometimes when work and play are done and evening stars appear, I feel like whispering to the moon, I wish you could be near. So every night when we finish our play, we know so well to end each day, we look forward to a bedtime story. How tired I am at the end of the day, but I'm always thankful in every way for my friends and family. The end. That's a long one, right? And it says on the back, just before I go to bed, to me each night a book is read. Do you guys get a book at night?
Yeah.
Isn't it nice to have that time with your family? So, go ahead and sit down. Let's pray, okay? Let's put our hands together. Oh, dear Lord, thank you for these beautiful smiling faces in front of me. Thank you for the books that we get to read for with our family. And thank you for those lessons it teaches us in life. And I hope, Lord, and pray that all these children can follow in your footsteps. In your name we pray. Amen. Okay, let's go with Miss Liz.
This morning we continue our study in the book of Ephesians, and last week it was a pretty heavy time together, and today is going to be a little lighter, but it's going to be more practical. Last week we talked about the theology of why we are to do what we are to do. If we remember, the first three chapters in the book of Ephesians tells us who we are in Christ and what we have in Christ, all the abundance of the blessings that he's given us, the unity that we have in him, and how he desires for us to be one together, living in the truth of the gospel, knowing that we full well have salvation through salvation by grace, through faith and not of ourselves, but it is a gift of God. He has called us to be one body, with one spirit, with one baptism, and one Lord over all and in us all. And so as we as brothers and sisters come to worship, we recognize the fact that God has gifted us, that he has gifted you individually with many gifts, more than one probably, to use for his glory, for the benefit of the building up of the body of Christ, and to be a light into the world around us. And last week we saw how emphatic Paul was about that when we become Christians, that when we come to follow Jesus Christ, that when we yield our lives to him as our Lord and Savior, that something dramatically changes in our life. We don't just add Jesus into our already sinful experience and just say, well, now that we've got Jesus, we're going to heaven. No, the reality is that when we have Jesus, Jesus comes into our life by the power of his Spirit, and he rejuvenates us. He renews us. He makes us new people. He makes us new in Christ. And now the righteousness of God is upon us, not our own righteousness that we've earned, but his righteousness because of what he has done on the cross. And Paul reminds us that we are different. And last week we embraced the idea that those that are outside the body of Christ have a darkened way of thinking. They do not understand the things of God. And because of that, they have lost all sensitivity to God because of the hardness of their heart. They have a willful ignorance about the things of God. And because of this, we saw how God's wrath is being poured out upon those who do not yield their life to him. That even though God reveals himself in his creation and has given mankind the ability to know that there is a creator out there, that there is something beyond themselves that they can't pursue, and as they would do that, God would reveal himself more clearly. And yet humanity has chosen to go the other direction by making gods of their own making, making gods of their own imaginations so that they might serve themselves instead of serving the risen and holy Christ. So he tells us that we should no longer live in the Gentiles in the futility of their mind. We live in a similar culture that the Ephesians lived in. Paul is addressing a culture of the Ephesians that we can relate to today. With all the things that are going on in our world, they were happening in Ephesus at the same time. And we saw how the decisions that we make create a lifestyle. And the decisions that we make without Christ, without God, creates a lifestyle of godlessness and wickedness, darkening our understanding to what truly is the most important things in life, and that is to give God glory and to know that he loves you and to know that he paid the price for you and for me so that we might have eternal life when we trust him. And so Paul continues this thought, and he comes to the understanding that we not only have to take off the old, but we have to put on the new as well. Last week we talked about taking off the old and putting on the new, and Paul continues his thought by getting more practical. So if you have your Bibles this morning, please turn to Ephesians chapter 4, and we'll begin in verse 25, and we'll read through the end of the chapter. Hear the word of the Lord. Therefore, you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to his neighbor, for we are all members of one body. In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you are still angry. And do not give the devil a foothold. He who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work, doing something useful with his own hands, that he may have something to share with those in need. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building up others according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness, rage, and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. May God add the blessing to the reading of his word, and please pray with me this morning. Again, Lord, we turn to your word, we turn to the Bible to seek your knowledge, we seek you, Lord. We ask that you would transform us by the renewing of our minds, that your word would come alive in us, that we would take this passage and take it to heart because it relates to everything that we do about who we are as your people. And we thank you, Lord, that you have given us this instruction so that we might know what pleases you, that we might know what doesn't grieve the Holy Spirit, that we know how to be able to not give Satan a foothold into our lives. And so this morning we look for your help in this regard, in Jesus' name. Amen. Paul continues his emphatic teaching on this. Remember that Paul is very serious when it comes to being a different person as we learn to live the Christian life. I have a few general thoughts before we get started on these five elements of what he's going to be talking to us. There are things in these five elements that are common to all of us. They will apply to each one of us. So I would encourage each one to consider how God might be speaking to you as we go through these together. John Stott reminds us that we can't be good in a vacuum. That Paul's main concern for us is that we have unity in the body, that we are one in Christ. The concept of being in Christ is what he wants us to know, what it means to be in Christ, and how do we respond to one another when we are in Christ, and how the world views us, and how we portray the gospel message, and how we portray Jesus Christ while we are in Christ. So what we are doing is fostering unity. It is not enough to put on the old self, but we must put on the new self. It's not good enough to just get rid of the bad stuff. We need to put on the good stuff as well. Last Thursday in our men's group, John mentioned this quote by Oswald Chambers, and it's very fitting for us today. He says this, "You did not do anything to achieve your salvation, but you must do something to exhibit it." You remember when we were studying James, how James made that very clear to us as well, that faith without works is dead. That it's not good enough for us to just believe the right stuff, but we have to take those theological truths and put them into practice. Doctrine and theology is good to get started, but doctrine and theology is dead without it being acted out in our daily lives as brothers and sisters. You see, our beliefs and our behaviors are woven together. We do what we believe. We might say we believe something, but if we don't do it, we really don't believe it. We just have a head knowledge about what it means. But in the Christian life, in our worldview, we understand that believing the right things about God, and that's what Paul has done in the first three chapters, now has to be enmeshed with our actions in our daily lives. We saw last week that the choices in the lifestyle of those that were wicked, those that were pagans, led to a godless life, darkened in their understanding. How these thoughts and how these choices make a difference in who we are. And so today we're going to describe, Paul wants us to know, how we can make those choices in regards to eternal life, in regards to understanding what God really wants us to be about. We are taking off the old, and now we are putting on the new. The first one, therefore each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully. Romans 1:25 reminds us of the fact that we have, as a human race, have exchanged the truth for a lie. The truth being that the God of all creation is sovereign. He is Lord of all. And as he has become, as he is Lord of all, we have recognized the fact that our lives are under his care. But the world has traded that truth for a lie that basically says, he is not sovereign in my life, and I will create my own reality. I will create my own God to satisfy my own earthly, fleshly desires. You see, this comes from a darkened mind. And this first lie took place even in the garden of when Adam and Eve took and ate of that fruit, Satan lied to them and said that they would become like gods. And because of that lie, the whole idea of lying has become part of who we are as human beings. This has everything to do with lying. You see, when we lie, guess whose language we're talking about? The scripture is very clear that lying is Satan's language. That's what he does. That's his native tongue. And when we lie, we are speaking his language. He is the father of all lies, John 8:44 says. And he reminds us that we are to speak the truth in love. But how do we lie? Well, most of us know that. Most of us know that we lie by not telling the truth. We spread rumors is one way that we lie. We gossip. We tell secrets about other people. We slander other people. There's an interesting song by one of the Beatles, not Paul, not Ringo, not John, but George. George Harrison wrote a song actually called Gossip, the Devil's Radio. And in that song, he rightly understands the fact that when we gossip, we are the devil's radio. You see, we take gossip pretty lightly, don't we? We're just sharing information. We're not really doing anybody any harm. But in reality, when we gossip and we spread rumors, we are telling half-truths, and what half-truths are lies. We have just juicy tidbits about someone's reputation. We have half-truths and innuendos that make people think that we are in the know. And we want people to look at us and say, well, you must know something that I don't know, therefore I must go to you and you must be better than me because you know these things. Lying is not just telling non-truths, but lying is telling half-truths for our benefit. We tell half-lies when we butter people up. When we want to get something from somebody else, we'll tell them a half-truth so that they might look at us more favorably. I know we tell lies to get out of trouble. We tell lies to stay out of trouble. We tell lies to make ourselves look better than someone else. Our whole culture is lying. Can we trust our government? Can we trust the people in power? And how do we discern the truth from the lie? As Christians, this is a huge part of who we are to be. This is why I think Paul reminds us that this is the first one. You see, a huge part of who we are as Christians and what our witness is to the world is that we are to be trusted in what we say. Many people might not agree with our worldview, but what they should say about us is that I might not agree with your worldview, but I trust what you're saying. I know that what you're saying into you is the truth. And as we see this in our own walk with the Lord, we recognize that it is a reflection of our own relationship with God. James 5 tells this, do not swear by heaven or earth, but let your yes be yes and your no be no. We are to be quick to listen and slow to speak. I read somewhere that we speak 17,000 words a day. I didn't count mine. I don't know how they figured that out. But that's a lot of language. And so we need to be careful. We are to speak the truth so that we can be trusted. We are to be joined together in one body. Why are we to be trusted? Because we are members of one another. This is what Paul says. That we are members of one body. That as brothers and sisters, we must speak the truth to one another so that the world knows that we are special and unique, that we are truthful in what we say. Jesus said this, if you obey my words, you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. He also said that in the last day when we come stand before the judgment of our Lord and Savior, that every word will be judged. We are to guard our tongue. Remember what James reminded us in James, that the tongue is like a fire. The tongue can spread wickedness in just a matter of moments. So we are to be trusted. How's your language? Is that something we, as a people, need to confess? That when we go to confession to the Lord, we confess the fact that we haven't been truthful. What lying does is it destroys, it tears, it hurts, It kills. Paul is very concerned about the unity of the body of Christ, and the way the unity stays together is when we tell each other the truth. Now, sometimes the truth can be hard to hear. Sometimes it can be hard to say. But we are to speak the truth in love. The second one. In your anger, do not sin. How do you do that? Did Jesus get angry? Yeah, he did. As a Christian, can we get angry? Yes. But there are two different kinds of anger, aren't there? There's what we call righteous anger, and there's what we call unrighteous anger. Verse 31, and we'll talk about this a little bit later on, but verse 31 gives us a hint of what unrighteous anger looks like. He says, get rid of all bitterness, rage, and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Yet righteous anger comes from what angers God. Now, I was thinking about this a little bit during the week and wondering, what is it that angers God as it is different from what angers us? Why was Jesus angry in the temple? Because they were offensive to the things of God. Those are the things that we need to be angry about. The things that offend God. The things like abortion that offends God. The things like our cultural disposition of our sexual immorality offends God. We need to stand up and be held accountable for the fact that we believe in the truth of the Scriptures, even though it might go against the flow of our worldview today, or the world's worldview today. You see, for us, anger usually is a second emotion. Usually we get angry because we get hurt or we're afraid of something, but it's usually something that it's not an initial emotion. Whereas with God, it's hard to use the word anger in the sense of a human anger because God is always angry against unrightfulness. He's always angry against sin. But his anger isn't a second emotion. His justice is his primary emotion. His love and justice are together, woven together, so that his love can be expressed through justice. And as he expresses that justice, the wrath of God is revealed against all ungodliness, like we learned last week. You see, we don't get angry at people when they offend us. We are told to turn the other cheek. We don't get angry when people are vindictive and have personal resentment against us when we are talking about the things of God. Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount that when people do that to you, be encouraged, be joyful, because they did that to me first. So we don't get angry, we don't get bitter, we don't get rage, because this kind of anger and bitterness and rage does nothing but destroy. All it can do is fester in your life. All it can do is stew up anger and emotions that are not healthy. In fact, when we hold our anger and bitterness inside, it can cause us to be pretty seriously ill physically. But we are to get angry against all ungodliness. If God is angry against sin, how much should we not be angry against all the things that displease God? That means in our own life, but in the life of our culture, in the life of the world around us, we must get angry at the sin in our own life. We must get angry at the fact that we have fallen short of the glory of God, and in that we come into true repentance. We're angry not because it is affecting us. We're angry because we have displeased the one who has given us life. And in order to rid ourselves of that guilt and of that anger, we turn to him for forgiveness so that we might again walk afresh in the newness of our relationship with God. Psalm 119:53 says this, indignation grips me because of the wicked who have forsaken your law. So indignation is something that should grip us when we or the wicked forsake God's laws. If no one's going to stand up for the things of God, God, by the power of his Holy Spirit, uses his church to stand up for what he wants us to stand up for according to the truth of the gospel message. At the same time, as I mentioned, we must remember our own fallenness. We must remember our own proneness to sin. We are not to judge others. That's God's job. We are to declare the truth of the Bible. We are to declare the truth of what God reveals in his word, and God to be the judge. And yet, we warn people. We warn those that they are falling short. We warn those that they are displeasing to God. They warn those that they are breaking God's law so that they might turn to receive forgiveness. James 1:19-20 says that we are to be slow to anger, remembering that the anger of man does not work out the righteousness of God. We must seek forgiveness and restoration. See, even in church discipline isn't for punishment, but church discipline is for restoration. So when Paul talks to the Corinthian church in 1 and 2 Corinthians, he has a corrective letters, not to punish them, but to correct them, to bring them back into a right relationship with himself and with each other. Third, exchanging stealing for sharing. Let him who once stole steal no longer. I remember when I was a young boy coming home from Marquez Elementary School in Pacific Palisades, walking down the street. There would be Pronto Market, there would be a delicatessen, and then there would be a little toy store. And I got caught stealing. We used to steal fizzies from Pronto Market. But I got caught stealing what they called flubber. I don't know if you remember that thing called flubber, but it was just a moldy thing, you know, fun to play with. And the way I got caught stealing was I went into the store and I stole one of them. And then my friend goes, "Will you go in and get me one?" And I went in and got him one. And then halfway home, one of my friends ran up to me and said, "Dale told on you. He told the guy that you stole." So I'm hiding all my stuff. And then I'm walking home, and all of a sudden my mom pulls up in her car. And I'm going, "What?" And she goes, "Get in." And I was busted. I don't know how she found out. But I got home and I don't think I ever stole again after my dad got done with me. But if we steal no longer, let him who once stole steal no longer. But that we would work, paying our debts is important, is it not? When we don't pay our debts, we are basically stealing. Cheating on our taxes. Whenever we cheat on our taxes, we're stealing. That we are to give unto Caesar what is Caesar's, and to give to God what is God's. Taking credit for someone else's work is stealing. Taking credit for someone else's work. Why should we work? The Bible tells us that if you don't work, you don't eat. That the idea of work, that God was all part of God's design. 6 days you shall work, and on the seventh day you shall rest. See, working is part of God's design for living. But why do we work? We work because we pay our debts. We work because we put food on the table. We work because we become a positive influence in society, but we also work not just for those immediate needs, but we work because we can be a blessing to others. Luke 14:13 reminds us of this, that when you give a feast, don't call the rich, but call the poor and the maimed, the lame and the blind, so that you will be blessed, because they cannot pay you. You see, we work not just for ourselves, but we work to give to others who cannot work for themselves, who cannot prepare their own livelihoods, but that we might be able to share with those that are in need. Matthew 25 reminds us of this, doesn't it? Jesus with the sheep and the goats. As much as you've done this unto the least of these, my brethren, you've done it unto me. And what he's talking about is feeding and clothing, visiting. That as much as you've done it to the least of my brethren, you've done it unto me. Paul's taking gifts from the churches in Asia Minor in Acts 24 and presenting them as he stands before Felix in his defense, stands before Felix and says, Felix, I've gathered all this money from churches in the churches to come and bring to the poor in Jerusalem. So part of who we are as Christians is to meet the needs of those that are less fortunate, to meet the peds who cannot work. But those that can work, they need to work. How do we steal from God? We steal from God by withholding the gifts that he's given us. God, we've learned earlier that he has blessed us with all these gifts so that the body of Christ might be built up into the head of Jesus Christ, being founded on the foundations of the apostles and the prophets, with Jesus as the chief cornerstone, that we would rise up to be the temple of God, representing God into this world and being held in high esteem by God himself, doing what he wants us to do. We steal from God not only by neglecting our gifts, but we steal from God by withholding our tithes and our offerings. Malachi 3:8 reminds us of this. Malachi the prophet says, the question was asked, how do we steal from you, God? By not giving the full amount of our tithes and our offerings. Malachi 3:10 reminds us that we are to bring the whole tithe, and that we are to watch God multiply those for his glory in the building up of the church. We are to give generously what God has given us. We are to give with joy and thanksgiving what God has prepared for us. And yet we are to give for the work of God. Number four, don't use your mouth for evil. Instead, use it for good. Oh, here's my quote. What did I say? Did I say 7,000 words a day? Yeah, I got it right. 7,000 words a day. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for the building up of others, according to their needs, not yours. Again, what happens when you open your mouth? You know, our speech is a gift from God. It's one thing that separates us from the animals. I mean, we could teach a parrot to say a couple words or something like that, but for the most part, one of the things that separates us from the human race, I mean, from the animals, is the fact that God has given us a language. He's given us many languages to glorify him with it, to encourage and build up others, and yet we so often use it to tear people down. We so often use it to spread those rumors, those lies, and those slanders. But we are to engage our minds. That's why Romans tells us that we are to be transformed by the renewing of our minds, so that our minds might be thinking clearly in the line of what God would have us be thinking about, so that we might declare his goodness to the world around us. Use our tongues to build up others for the needs of their purposes, so that those around us who listen might know that these Christians, even though they might not understand or might not agree with my worldview, the way that they talk to me, it's different than the way that the other people talk to me. While we are angry We are to sin not. While we can become angry, we are not to have malice or bitterness or angst, but we are to know the truth, and the truth will set us free. You see, we can disagree with somebody and not have it be belligerent. We are a new creation in Christ, and our speech should reflect that. We are a new self. Instead of hurting people, instead of always focusing our attention upon ourselves, we are to use the language that God has given us to encourage, to cheer, to comfort, and to lovingly correct. When's the last time you encouraged somebody? Maybe just for no reason. Just to come up to a brother or sister in Christ and say, you know what? I want to encourage you today. Or to have someone come to you and just give you a good cheer. We should be the happiest people on earth, right? That the joy of the Lord is our strength. Why not let it show? So many times we are kind of hunkering down, holding on to the things so tightly that we do not express the joy of the Lord in our lives. We are to cheer and to comfort, to have empathy towards one another, to understand where people are coming from so that we might minister to their needs and to their lives. Proverbs 12:18 says this, "Reckless words pierce like a sword, but the tongue of the wise bring healing." Then verse 30 says this, "Do not grieve the Holy Spirit, from whom you are sealed for the day of redemption." In verse 27, we saw where we are not to give the devil a foothold. Well, what does that foothold mean? Well, it means we are not to give the devil an opportunity to have a connection in our lives. Whether it be the way that we talk to one another, whether it be the way we live our lives. But we are not to give the devil a foothold. I thought about the idea of a foothold in the sense of rock climbing. A foothold would be a place where you can put your foot so that you can go up the mountain. We don't want to give Satan a foothold into our lives so that he can infiltrate even deeper into who we are as brothers and sisters in Christ. We do not want to have Satan have a grab upon our feet, not even just a little bit. We don't give Satan that opportunity, and that's what brings glory to God. But what brings God grief, what grieves the Holy Spirit, is that when we do yield and succumb to these things, when we yield and succumb to disunity, that causes grief to the Holy Spirit. When we disobey the things of God, that brings grief to the Holy Spirit. He is grieved when we misuse our words. He is grieved when we exuberate unrighteous anger, when we allow our emotions to get the best of us, when we allow our sinful desires to express themselves in hate, when we do not grow up into the headship of Christ, but when we go our own way, seeking our own desires. See, the Holy Spirit is the one, remember, who seals us, who gives us the promise of our eternal life, who enables us to know the truth so that we can go in the truth. He has begun and has secured our eternal salvation, as yet we have that eternal salvation. Therefore, we are to live in a new life. Number five, last one. Exchanging unkindness and bitterness for loving kindness. This is putting on the old and putting on the new. We are to get rid of all bitterness. Have you ever heard of the term, you're just being a sourpuss? Or I think my wife used this word on our kids every now and then. Didn't she used to call them grumpy two-shoes? Was that you? Yeah. Are you just being a grumpy two-shoes? Meaning the disposition of, I'm just grumpy all the time. I have a bitter disposition. I'm sour. I'm angry. Put aside all bitterness, the scriptures tell us, Paul says. That a Christian should not be a bitter person at all. That even though things that are going on in the world might make us bitter, but we have the hope of Christ in us. Rage, the outpouring of hostility towards someone else in yelling or uncontrolled screaming and throwing tantrums or physically harming somebody. We are to get rid of all rage, this outpouring of hostility. We aren't hostile towards people that we disagree with. We are loving towards people that we disagree with. We speak the truth in love. We are under control of the power of the Holy Spirit. We do not have unholy, selfish anger, but we let the Holy Spirit draw us into a way of being able to express the truth in love. Brawling and slander, blaspheming, both physical and emotional abuse, raising our voices, violent political demonstrations or riots. We do not engage in these things because they are not of the new self. The new self, we are to be loving and kind. We are not to have any form of malice or wishing of evil upon anybody. But we are silently building within us a sense of God's purpose by the power of His Spirit. Let me ask you this. Do you silently hold grudges? Do you have a grudge that you're holding on to from maybe years ago? That's what malice is all about. Holding that grudge, plotting evil for somebody's demise, silently holding those grudges so that you might feel better about yourself, but in reality, you're only harming yourself. If anyone says that they love God and hates his brother, is a liar. For anyone who does not love his brother whom he has seen cannot love God whom he has not seen. We are to be kind and compassionate, loving and forgiving one another. The word kind in the Greek is Christos. It's almost like Christos, associated with the name of Christ, because Christ is kind. We are to be Christ-like. When you open your mouth, do things that come out that are kind? We are to forgive and have compassion. We are to be tender-hearted and forgiving one another. Micah 6:8. You have known thee, O man, what is good and what God requires of thee, to act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with God. Psalm 103:8. This is what I'll close off with this. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in love. That is the new self. That we are to be compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in love. May that be evident in our lives as a community, as a church, and that be the identity of who we are as individuals as we continue to grow to the headship of our Lord Jesus Christ. Would you pray with me? Our Heavenly Father, we do thank you for this instruction, this practical application of the things that we've learned before, that we are to put off our old and to put off our new, that we are to work out our salvation in fear and trembling, knowing that you are in us, guiding and directing us as we yield our lives to you. And so, Lord, this morning we come seeking you. We come that you would guide us further down the road as far as our walk with you, that we would trust you even more, that we would put these things into practice, that they would become our DNA. We thank you, Lord, for guiding us. We thank you for this word. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Well, we have a new song, and it is what the psalm Glenn just read, Psalm 103. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. Please stand. God is slow to anger when I go astray. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. All of my betrayals he will not repay. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Mercy and compassion, his great love is proved. He covers my transgressions like the snow. As far as east from west are all my sins removed. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. He saved me from the pit when I had lost all hope. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Endless springs of kindness, all his blessings flow. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Our days will fade like flowers and are quickly spent. Like the wind, our years will come and go. Everlasting favor is his covenant. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Merciful and gracious, merciful and gracious is my God to me. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. And I will tell his goodness through eternity. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Bless the Lord, you angels, all you heavenly hosts, every living creature here below. Praise the Father, praise the Son, and Holy Ghost. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord, you angels, all you heavenly hosts, and every living creature here below. Praise the Father, praise the Son, and Holy Ghost. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Bless the Lord, oh my soul.
Yeehaw!
You may be seated, and if Kathy would come up for prayers.
Glenn did a better job on that sermon. I didn't need his notes. He wouldn't like me doing it. Good morning. My name is Kathy Wallen, and it is my privilege to lead us as we lift our prayer requests up to God this morning. The Lord our God is worthy of all our praise. He hears our cries when we call out to him, and he answers our prayers according to his will. According to Psalm 145, verses 17 through 19, the Lord is righteous in all his ways and faithful in all he does. The Lord is near to all who call on him, to all who call on him in truth. He fulfills the desires of those who fear him. He hears their cry and saves them. Please join me in prayer for the following concerns. We continue to pray for the search team as they are seeking to fill the position of Youth and Family Outreach Director. We ask, Lord, that you guide the ideal person to apply. Give the team wisdom and insight as they review the applications and interview the applicants. Work out the details and human hurdles. We thank you, Lord, that we are able to add this position to our staff. Father, we lift up Elle and Dave Seymour as they are facing health decisions regarding treatments for Elle. We ask that you give Elle and Dave great peace as they consider the correct path to take and help them to feel your presence every step of the way. We ask for peace and a good outcome for a procedure later this week for Elle. Keep Elle and Dave, help Dave and Elle to remember that our God is the great physician and it is all in his hands. We also continue to pray for David, Don Fredrickson's brother, who continues to fight a rare neurological disorder that has had him hospitalized for the last 2.5 months. David has a long fight ahead, but the family is seeing some progress and continues to lean on God and depend on him as he is working in David's body to bring about healing. Lord, guide the medical staff as they minister to David and give peace to the family. Lord, we ask you for continued healing and the recovery of strength for Bonnie McLean so that she can be discharged from Val Verde Rehabilitation. Guide the family as they make the necessary adjustments to welcome her home. We thank you that Greg and Joyce Milliken had a safe trip and a good visit with Greg's brother Gary, who is in hospice care for throat cancer. Lord, we pray for your continued peace and comfort for Gary, and we pray that his family would turn to you and lean on you through this time. Margie Bonazzola has a doctor appointment on Wednesday. We ask for peace and assurance that everything will go well. Lord, please give Margie a joyous birthday on Wednesday with a positive outcome from her appointment. We lift up praise for the following joys. Heavenly Father, we give you praise for Adam and Melissa's new baby, who was born about 2 weeks ago. We praise you for a safe delivery and ask you to bless the growing family as big sister Frankie and big brother Wiley welcome their new sibling. This Thursday, May 26th, Jim and Phyllis Axtell will be celebrating their 79th wedding anniversary. We give thanks to you, Lord God, for blessing them both with a long life and a long marriage. We ask all of these things in Jesus' precious name. Now please join me in praying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I'd like to ask those that are coming to receive our tithes and our offerings to come at this time. And as we continue to worship the Lord in the giving of our tithes and our offerings, let us do it with joy and thanksgiving in our hearts this morning.
Thank you.
Slide, please. Thank you. Let's say this together as we go. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.